Okay. In this hour of this course, we're going to discuss the dynamic neural network structure. Okay, this neural network structure is proposed probably in 94 or 93 by two Indian researchers, and it basically is based on a second order filter structure as the synaptic operation, the left part of this diagram, and a gain and a nonlinear activation function which lies on the rightmost part of this neural network structure as the somatic operation. Okay, the left hand side of this neuron structure contains two delay elements. I mean, you apply an input variable, input value to here, there is a summation, there is a delay element, there is another delay element. The outputs of those delay elements are multiplied by some gains you see here, okay? And they provide a negative feedback to this summation block. And the outputs together with this intermediate value are combined together to obtain the output of the second order filter structure. The filter is second order because there are two delay elements. This is a very simple and very, I mean, well-known structure in filters theory, in, let's say, discrete time systems theory, okay? And you obtain the output of this structure, it multiplied by phi I 6 as the somatic gain and pass the net summation, pass the response through this F function to obtain the response of a single neuron structure, okay? So since this structure has two delay elements, it is a dynamic structure that contains memory, okay? That contains the, that remembers the previous values of these signals. So the question here is that how can I merge a number of such neurons to build up a network structure? And how can I tune these phi I1, phi I2, phi I3, phi I4, and phi I5 parameters and phi I6 parameters to obtain a desired performance from this network structure? Okay, how can I tune the parameters of this structure? And how can I build up a neural network mechanism, let's say, okay? The second question is simple. You apply the same input to these dynamic neural units, okay, DNUs. This is the first neuron, that is the second neuron, and that is the nth neuron. You add up, you sum the responses of each neurons together to obtain the network structure. And you apply this output to somewhere, obtain an error measure, and your update algorithm updates the parameters of your your particular neurons available in your structure. We will see how this happens. But I need to remind you that VIK is computed by phi I1 times UIK, phi I2 times UIK minus 1, phi I3 times UIK minus 3, 2, minus phi I4 times UIK minus 1, phi I5 times UIK minus 2. This is this synaptic sum describes the operation that takes place on the left-hand side of this neuron structure, okay? This neuron structure. Basically, we write the transfer function from VI of capital Z to UI of capital Z. Z is the Z transform variable to obtain the transfer function. And after that, we write this difference equation. Basically, VI Z over UI Z is equal to phi I1 plus phi I2 Z to the minus 1 plus phi I3 Z to the minus 2 over 1 plus phi I 4z to the minus 1, phi I 5z to the minus 2, okay? It is not so difficult, but the time domain relation that relates the input and output is given by this equation, okay? So when you obtain Vik, you multiply it by phi I6 to obtain the net summation that is going to be passed through the nonlinear activation function F, and you take this function to obtain the output of your single neuron. And you combine, without any weights, you combine the outputs of those neurons to build up a particular network output, okay? Now the question is, if there is an error measure, that is the difference between some d minus this tau, how can I go back to tune this parameter and the phi parameters you see in this difference equation? In this slide, phi I 1 to 6 are the adjustable parameters, and our parameter update strategy for dynamic neural network structure is the error backpropagation mechanism. So this is a recurrent, this is a feedback type of a neural network structure. So it has memory, that is because it is a dynamic neural structure. Okay, the slide looks complicated, but it is not. The k parameter, k value is indexing the time, okay? So j is the cost, that is the difference that defines 1 over 2 times the error squared, okay? Error k is the error observed at time k. So, and my network response is tau k, that is the summation of the outputs of each individual neurons. That is, I runs from 1 to n, capital N, you sum up oi k's, okay? For the response at time k, that is tau k, okay? And oik seen in this output equation are computed by using this expression. And f is the nonlinear activation function we choose in our network structures. Now, I will apply the gradient descent rule, that is delta phi ij is equal to minus eta times del cost over del phi ij. This is my well-known gradient descent rule. Basically, it is equal to eta times error times del output over del chosen parameter. Let's take the partial derivative, this partial derivative, by using the chain rule of partial differentiation. That is equal to eta times error times del output over del network output over del neuron output, del neuron output over del summation value, net summation value over del phi ij, okay? We have all those five parameters here, except the sixth one, because sixth one is here, okay? Sixth one is here. We will consider this separately. So, this is equal to eta times error times del tau over del oi is equal to one. This is one. This term is one, okay? Del oi over del vi is equal to, it is given here, phi I6 times vi prime, f prime, okay, phi I6 times f prime of the argument of the function. Now we're gonna take the partial derivative of vi with respect to phi ij. We remember the dependence is given here. Del vi over del phi i1 produces ui. Del vi over del phi i2 produces ui k minus 1. Del vi over del phi i3 produces ui k minus 3. Del vi over del phi i4 produces minus vi k minus 1. And del vi over del phi i5 produces minus vi k minus 2. So it is really very simple to implement the tuning law given here. For the sixth one, minus eta del j over del phi i6 produces eta times error times delta over del phi i6. It is really very simple because it produces eta times error times delta over del oi, which is one. Del oi over del phi i6 gives you vi times, since you are taking the partial derivative with respect to this term, it is going to take out this term as a multiplier here, okay? And you're going to multiply this with f prime of its argument, okay, of f's argument. So a simple example, I have a transfer function. That transfer function describes a difference equation in time domain or a transfer function in frequency domain. This is my sampling time. This is in seconds, okay? And I have no information about the inside of this transfer function. So this produces my desired value, okay? There is a transfer function that produces my desired value, and the input is this input signal. And I will implement a dynamic neural network structure that is going to produce tau, and my goal is to obtain zero as the error, okay? This error is going to be used in the parameter update signal, and I would like to learn the dynamical properties of this red box within this blue box. So the tuning here is online. I will press the button and tuning is going to start, and my parameters will start changing, okay? The goal is to obtain this difference zero. And this system is called an identification mechanism. Basically, your dynamic neural network learns from your output observations. It learns the interior behavior or interior behavior, I mean, in the sense of input-output behavior of your red box here, okay? So in an identification system, the input must be persistently exciting. I mean, it is an art to choose this input signal. Basically, if it is spectrally rich, it will be more healthy to obtain a good neural network mechanism, neural network identifier, if this is spectrally rich. We are considering only one frequency, but the response is still nice. We have two responses here. We have two responses. This is the error signal, okay? This is the error signal I obtain. Initial parameters are chosen from this range, and there were five such neurons, and this is my input signal, as you see in the time axis, okay? For this input signal, it produces very small errors. I mean, it is of course possible to choose larger number of neurons in this kind of a structure that may produce better responses. But there is one critical problem here, like the problem we mentioned in the radial basis function discussion. What about the stability in synaptic parts, okay? I mean, you are tuning the parameters of a second order filter structure you see here, but in order to obtain a stable left-hand side, this polynomial, I mean, this phi I4 and phi I5 must satisfy particular conditions, basically conditions like z square plus phi I4 z plus phi I5 is equal to zero polynomial must have roots that are within the unit circle in complex domain, okay? For stability, this structure must satisfy certain conditions, okay? And with that condition, with those conditions, you can implement this kind of a neural network structure safely. Otherwise, what happens? Otherwise, this system will produce responses that tend to infinity, and eventually your system will go unstable. So at each particular parameter update step, you have to check what is happening in your phi I4 and phi I5 parameters. This is important. I will stop here for dynamic neural network discussion and give 5 minutes break and then come back to discuss the third part. Okay.